Hi everyone. Hi, welcome again to the session. So I hope you all had a good day, and some of you had messaged a couple of questions on the group, so I was able to answer them. And अगर किसी के और कोई questions होंगे आज के session के लिए, आज हम question answer round में उनको answer करेंगे. कुछ अगर क्वेश्चंस रह जाएंगे तो आप लोग उसको व्हाट्सएप ग्रुप पर मैसेज कर सकते हैं, नॉर्मल मैसेज. सो आई सी अ लॉट ऑफ पीपल जॉइनिंग अस एंड आई विल टुडे हैंड ओवर द स्क्रीन टू करिश्मा एंड शी विल बी योर प्रेजेंटर टुडे एंड शी इज गोइंग टू टेक अप द सेशन. करिश्मा, वी आर गोइंग टू टॉक अबाउट मेंटल स्टेटस एग्जामिनेशन टुडे.
यस मैम.
Okay. So, why don't you begin? Karishma is a psychologist and she's working with us at Global Child Wellness Center, and she's brilliant with kids as well as with adults also in taking therapy sessions. And she's young and energetic, and she's going to talk and teach us a lot about mental status examination. Karishma, why don't you begin?
Okay, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am. Mom, can you make me the host because I'm not able to share the screen. Okay. Are you able to see my screen?
Yes.
Is my voice audible to all?
Yes. Vani, good okay. afternoon. Good afternoon, everyone.
Okay, let's start with today's topic, mental status examination. So the first question which arises in our mind is, what is mental status examination?
Before Karishma, you begin, let me tell a little bit about mental status examination from a practical point of view. See, what happens is, like we were talking yesterday, a lot about psychiatry and psychology becomes subjective. Subjective means I might perceive certain things and that might be different for you, or that might be different for another clinician, another doctor, another therapist, another social health, mental health worker. So sometimes what I feel and I see may be different for you. Now, in order to reduce all of this, in order to reduce this subjectivity, we have a set protocol, a set guideline in which we will examine the patient. Now, examining the patient also means that we need to start assessing the patient. The mental status examination is a cross-sectional examination. Cross-sectional means today, here and now, at this point of time, what is the patient feeling? What is the patient looking like? What is the patient appearing to be? Now, today my patient may seem sad. Tomorrow my patient may not seem sad. So it is just for the day. At the time when patient came to me, and the way patient was looking like, that is the assessment of that situation is called mental status examination. I am trying to simplify it a lot so that people who don't know what is mental status examination can understand it. Now it is divided into different kind of categories and different kind of headings. We will be taking up headings one by one. There might be some tough topics, there might be some tough definitions. Please bear with us. We will try to simplify it as much as possible. As I mentioned yesterday, a couple of sessions today and yesterday and maybe a little bit of tomorrow would be a little academically advanced, but as we progress, we will ease out into different disorders and it will become easier to understand as we go ahead. So one more thing that you need to understand is that to reduce the subjectivity, we have a set protocol and set guideline and then set headings under which we will be answering these questions. My question is, when do you start mental status examination? This is for people who are into psychology and who are into clinical psychology. When do you start mental status examination? Is it when you are finished with a history, or is it when you are trying to make a diagnosis? What time do you make? I would request everyone to keep interacting in the chat box so that we can have more and more enlightening discussion about this topic today. Before I allow Karishma to begin, let me answer this for you. Mental status examination begins the moment the patient enters your clinic, because the way they are dressed, yes, trying to take a history, the way they are dressed, the way they walk. No, Malvika, see, it does not depend upon the chief complaint. It does not depend upon the body and appearance. Yes, body and appearance is a part of mental status examination. And regardless of whatever the patient came with, whatever complaint they came with, the assessment begins right at the moment the patient presents to your clinic. You will have to see how they are looking, how they are dressed, what is their gait, how they are walking, how they are keeping their hands, how they are sitting, is there anything to notice? So all of that becomes a part of your observation. Mental status examination is not particularly done and written before the case history, but mentally in your mind, it should begin at the time the patient enters. Of course, the first thing to do is take the history only. Take the history and write the history, but I am saying that you must become aware of certain headings in the first go itself. When the patient walks to you, you should become observant enough to notice few points, which you can later write in the mental status examination once you are starting. MSC is for all patients, not for a specific disorder. You must do a good mental status examination because it is the combination of history and combination of good mental status examination that will guide you to a differential or to a good diagnosis. Yes, Rini, exactly. It's like reading a person. So Kritika, when you are reading a person, you just need to read the person in the beginning while taking the case history and write it in the headings once you are writing the mental status examination. Of course, agar kuch key points lagte hain, there are certain key points that you think that are very, very important, you can keep jotting them down at the same time also. Like what we used to do when we were residents is, suppose there's a patient who is psychotic and I can notice that the patient is not well groomed and his nails are not clipped or his hair are not very combed, or his shirt is out of the place, or the buttons are not done nicely. So while talking to the patient and taking history, I would flip the pages, open the mental status examination sheet and scribble a few points that, okay, this patient was not well groomed, so that I miss na kar do, that I just don't miss. But eventually, yes, first case history and then you eventually write the points. Okay, I think I've given a gist. Karishma, why don't you begin with the mental status examination and enlighten us with the details?
Sure, ma'am. Okay. So first question which come to our mind is, what is MSE, mental status examination? Mental status examination is standardized format in which clinician records the psychiatric signs and the symptoms present at the time of the interview. Now the here which question may come into your mind is how MSE is different from the case history. Now, in the case history, we will take a detailed information about the patient's illness and the signs and symptoms the patient talking about. But in the mental status examination, we will focus on the psychiatric signs and symptoms which are present at the time of the interview. As the ma'am said, when the patient just enter in the room, that you start looking at the patient and start observing some points. As side by side, as you observe something strange in the patient, you just note down it, you go back and just note down under the heading of mental status examination. So next is why we do MSE. The purpose is to evaluate quantitatively and qualitatively a range of mental functions and behaviors at a specific point in the time. Now the MSE provides important information for the diagnosis and for the assessment of disorder's course and response to the treatment. The observation noted throughout the interview become the part of MSc, which begin when the clinician first meets the patient. Information is gathered about the patient's behavior, thinking, and mood. So for doing MSc, you should have good observational skills, okay? So what are the points to be covered in the MSc? Is number A, at A, it is journal appearance and behavior, B, speech, C, mood and affect, D, thought, E, perception, F, cognition, G, insight, H, judgment. Now, as some points, as we are having a topic of phenomenology in the tomorrow session, but when we go through the MSc, we come to realize that there are so many things of phenomenology which were covering in the MSc. So we will be taking tomorrow's session little bit today with along with the MSc and with tomorrow's session. We have divided this session into three parts, and then we will go through phenomenology along with the MSc. Now the word phenomenology comes to your mind, that what is phenomenology? Phenomenology is basically a discipline which formed a bridge between the psychology and the philosophy. The phenomenology basically a psychological study of subjective experience. It means that it includes the all the terms which is help us in explaining the subjective experience of the patient. Now, today we will be covering A, B, and C part, and tomorrow we will be covering D and E part, and the rest is to be covered afterwards, that is F, G, and H part. Because MSc is so much in detail, and we want you to have a complete detail about MSc. So we will be starting with journal appearance and behavior. Now, what points are to be covered in the journal appearance and behavior? Number one is journal appearance. Number two, attitude towards examiner. Number three, comprehension. Number four, client and posture. Number five, psychomotor activity. Number six, social manner and nonverbal behavior. Number seven, report. Number eight, hallucinatory behavior. Now, in the journal appearance, what are the important points to be noted? First is physique and body habitus and the physical appearance. That is how the patient is looking out. What is the size and the shape of the body of the patient? That has to be noted down in this point. Whether the patient looks comfortable or uncomfortable, that is has to be noted down. Physical health, is the person is physically fit or not, that is to be noted here. Grooming, hygiene or self-care, whether the patient is bathed, had taken the bath, and whether the patient has do the brush thing and everything. Sometimes the patient come to our clinic and they have not taken the brush, they have not done with the brush thing, and the smell is coming out of their mouth. So all that things are to be covered in this point.
Karishma, can I interrupt? I had an interesting question in my mind. So what is the difference between well-groomed and well-dressed? So you said grooming and dressing, they are two different points. Why are these two different?
Ma'am, because in the grooming part, ma'am, may I have to explain that? Or you want to ask from audience?
No, I'm asking the audience. I think everybody can answer this. What is the difference between grooming and dressing? So, if you are well dressed today at home, but you are not groomed because of the lockdown, you can't go and visit the parlor. Are you well groomed? Are you well dressed? Yes. Manjot, you are very correct. Dressing means clothes, and grooming means making hair and other things. Grooming is well kept, like hair and nails or cutting. And grooming means according to weather and trend. Great. Everybody is answering very well. Great. Karishma, so you did not have to answer this. People are very good. They know what we are talking about. You can continue now.
Okay. Very nice replies. Yeah, everybody is saying right. So grooming and dressing, you know now. Next is faces. Faces is basically the non-verbal expressions of the patient that has to be noted in it. Now, our next point is attitude towards examiner. Whether the patient is cooperative with you or it is he or she is uncooperative with you, that has to be mentioned. Attentiveness is that when you are asking a question to a patient, whether the patient is paying attention to that. Next is appears interested, disinterested, and apathetic. Means whether the patient is taking interest in your conversation or not interested in your conversation, or apathetic means showing no interest in the conversation. Next is any ingratiating behavior. Now, what is ingratiating behavior? Ingratiating behavior is that when sometime patient comes to your clinic and try and speaks like that, ma'am, I have did this thing like this and that, and ask you whether I have done it right or wrong. When the patient is trying to take your intent, taking your attention towards whether the patient has done something is right or wrong, trying to get your favor, that is the initiating behavior. Okay. Next is comprehension. Comprehension, you know very well what is comprehension. You have to see whether the comprehension is intact or impaired. That has to be noted down under this heading. Next is grind in posture. Grind in posture is normal or abnormal. The way of sitting, standing, walking, lying, all has to be recorded here. Now, I have seen a patient of schizophrenia with that patient is in same posture for so many long hours. So that kind of behavior, if you saw in some patient, you have to record about that in this point. Okay. Now, in the simple way, if we talk about in clinics, when the patient comes to your room and put their legs on the table, that is also something which is not a respectful behavior. That kind of behavior, if you saw with some patient, that is to be noted down under grind and posture. Next is psychomotor activity. Now, the first question arises in your mind, what is psychomotor activity? So, psychomotor activity basically are those motor activities which involve the mental functions. Okay, so those all those activities which involve mental function, motor activities which involve mental function is the psychomotor activity. You have to observe whether it is increased or decreased, whether there is any abnormal involuntary movement, is there any restlessness in the patient, is there any social withdrawal in the patient, compulsive act, ritual, or habits, or note down the reaction time. Is that when you asked a patient some question, whether the patient is replying or not on the time or not. Next, we have social manner and non-verbal behavior. You have to note down whether the non-verbal behavior is increased or decreased, or it is or the patient is showing any inappropriate behavior. The most important here is the eye contact, whether the patient is staring at the examiner, whether the patient is hesitant, having a hesitant eye contact, or if there is also a normal eye contact, that also has to be recorded. One patient come to my clinic, that patient is talking to me, giving her details, but she was having a hesitant eye contact. That is, she is seeing on the ground floor, not doing a conversation with eye contact. Next is rapport. In the rapport, whether a working relationship can be established with the patient should be mentioned. Now, what you have to write in it, sometimes the patient comes to your clinic and talk with you, but don't give much details. Means there is some time to be required to make a proper rapport with the patient. So that thing is to be mentioned in the MSC, because when the patient were referred to the therapist or some therapist about how the things, which therapy is to be applied on the patient, if the therapist see that the rapport is not built good, so the patient will, the therapist will give time to the patient to get open up and talk more about themselves, so that what the further procedure has to be followed with the patient is to be clarified. Next is hallucinatory behavior. Smiling or crying without reason, muttering or talking to the self, that is to, if you see some behavior like this, you have to note down under this hallucinatory behavior heading. Next is odd gesturing in response to auditory or visual hallucination. That is, if here one example come to my mind is that I saw a patient. She was a 16-year-old girl. She saw a boyfriend of her, which is in reality not present, but she was talking to that boyfriend. She was seeing that boyfriend also and talking with that boyfriend also. That's, as a therapist, it seems to be very weird for us. But that kind of behavior, if you saw in somebody, you have to mention in MSE under the heading of hallucinatory behavior. Next topic, we have speech. Now, in the speech, which topics we are going to cover is the rate and quantity of the speech, volume and tone of the speech, flow and rhythm of the speech. Rate and quantity of the speech. Whether the speech is present or absent, that is, you have to see if a child comes to you, whether the child was able to speak or not. If present, if he was able to speak, whether it is spontaneous, whether the productivity is increased or decreased, that has to be mentioned. Rate is rapid or slow, pressure of speech or a poverty of speech. Whether the rate of the speaking of the patient is fast or slow, that has to be mentioned. Sometimes the patient or a child come to our clinic and they keep on speaking without taking a pause. That is something come under the pressure of speech, that they have a pressure in their speech. Or the poverty of speech, that is the patient or the child is not able to speak even a single word. He or she speaks the have the quality of speaking, but they are not speaking so much. Next is the volume and the tone of speech. You have to note whether it is increased or decreased or it is appropriate. That you have to record. Whether it is very low, very high or normal pitch, that you have to record under the heading of volume and tone of speech. Now, next is the flow and the rhythm of speech. Okay, so you have to notice that whether the flow or rhythm of the speech is smooth, hesitant or blocking. Okay, and next, there are some terms which you may seem very difficult, but it is not really difficult as this is also a part of phenomenology. Now, I will explain you all these terms with the help of a good examples. Maybe you like it. Okay, so first is stammering. Stammering is basically taking an unusual pauses in the statements. Okay, the patient suddenly pause in between and then continue its statement. For example, a child come to me and he was saying a line that I think that you are very smart. So that is an example of stammering. Okay, so I think you have cleared with the stammering. What is stammering? Next is clustering. Now, what is clustering? In the clustering, the content is not coordinated. Like the patient or the child is not able to clearly say you what he or she trying to say. Like in clustering, I give you an example that I asked the child to tell me the story of Thirsty Crow. So what he told me that is, once upon a time, there was a thirsty crow. Thirsty crow finding water, saw pot, come near pot, put pebble, water cup goes up, drink water and flew. Now here the content is not associated. The content is not making any sense. The child is not able to clearly tell about what he or she is trying to say. Now, next is circumstantiality. Now, what is circumstantiality? Is that when the patient is when you ask something to the patient just get driven from the central theme. Now, if I asked the patient that, just say one of my real case I will like to discuss, after 2-3 sessions, I asked my patient, she is 33-year-old female. So I asked her that, is your husband supportive? So she gave me the reply. He is very arrogant. He is very strict. He doesn't talk to me so in a good manner. He keep on fighting with me. But sometimes he see the children of ours, sometimes take a care of them. But at the end, then she replied, yeah, my husband is little bit supportive. So here what the patient has did is, I asked the question, is the patient supportive or not? Is the husband supportive or not? Now the what the patient said me, he tell the extra things to me, extra things which is not related to the central theme. But at the end, she concluded the all the things to a central theme. Means ke wo pehle idhar udhar se सारा कुछ उसने मुझे बता दिया और जो उससे पूछा गया था वो उसने बिल्कुल एंड में बताया कि हाँ थोड़ा सा सपोर्टिव है. Next is tangentiality. Now, what is in the tangentiality? When you ask something to the patient get drive off from the central theme. Let's say, for example, a real case example I want to discuss on this is that I ask the patient that how is your mood? Now, the patient tell me mood. Okay. The mood, ma'am, I got negative thoughts in my mind. And when the negative thoughts come into my mind, I feel very lonely. When I feel lonely, I start reading book. When I don't get interest in the book, I start reading and I start doing another activity. Now, here what the patient is doing, when you ask the patient that how is your mood, the patient is not telling you what you have asked the patient. That is, the patient just go far away from the central theme. And what is the difference between circumstantiality and the tangibility is that in the circumstantiality, the patient get off the track, but at the end come to the central theme. But in the tangentiality, the patient starts with it, but go off track and never return back to the central theme. Next is the flight of idea. Now, what is the flight of idea? In the flight of idea, a beautiful example I will like to discuss of my real case. There was a patient of mine. She was interested. She was taking a funny story for that. So the and started, may I tell you the my story? I'm going to win the competition. I said, okay, you just start. So she started with the like, ma'am, you know what? There are the four participants in the mission. Nay, there are three participants. Okay. And that we have three boys. No. There was one girl and two boys and two boys and girls. No. They had brother and sister. Now here you can see that how she is making flight of ideas. Means from she was having a rapid speech. Okay, now she was not losing the connection, but the speech was so rapid that is come under the flight of ideas. Next is the clang association. Now, in the clang association, the rhythm of the speech remains very pleasanting, but the content of the speech is not correct. Now, a beautiful example I came in my mind, which is related to the clang association, is one video is viral so many years ago. It's 2 to 3 years back. One song was viral. I will like to sing that song, which is a very funny song. Like, you are my pumpkin, hello honey bunny, feeling something, hello honey bunny, tukur. Now here you can see the clang association, because here you are seeing that music is very, the rhythm is very nice. Na 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 na. The rhythm is very nice, but the content is totally distorted. There is no association between the context of the thing. So if you ask the patient about any, the patient like to discuss any poetry with you, or patient like to discuss anything with you, you allow the patient. And if you saw something like clang association in their speech, you have to note down in the rhythm of speech. Next is mood and effect.
I'm going to interrupt. Can you please go on the back slide again? You had wonderful examples to share about flight of ideas and clang association. I want to talk a little bit about the speech. Please move to the back slide once again. Okay, so here we are talking about circumstantiality, tangentiality, flight of For people for whom these topics are new, I am going to share a document that will give you in detail, in depth about what is circumstantiality, what is flight of ideas, and what is tangentiality. So one thing you have to understand is that sometimes there is a term that is called verbigeration, or it is called word salad. Sometimes when you ask a patient, they say so many things and none of it makes sense. Matlab, wo kuch bhi bolte rehte and they are talking all the time, all the things that they are saying, all the words that they are saying, they don't mean anything, but the patient keeps on speaking and speaking and speaking. Mm-hmm. That generally happens in prisoners. So you need to understand that there are a lot of things about speech and about flight of ideas that we need to be clear about. I will also be sharing another document in which I will be talking about what is the difference between flight of ideas and loosening of association. I think loosening of association is not mentioned here. Now what happens is, suppose I start a topic and it is somewhat in relation to the next topic, then it is loosening. Okay, so derailment, loosening of association, and flight of ideas, these are three things we need to be careful about. Derailment means I ask you something like, what color of pen do you have? So the patients are saying, I have red color pen. Pens are very nice. They help us in writing. My friend also had a pen. But that friend was not a very good friend. I had a fight with her. I had a fight with many other people also. So you understand, I questioned about the pen and the patient started talking about the color of the pen, then about a friend, then about a fight, and then they picked up the topic about fight. So it is derailment, like they derailed from the topic, like train jo hai wo patri se thoda sa upar ke side par ho gayi. Okay, next is loosening of association. So loosening of association is, again I ask the same question, but between one sentence and the other sentence the patient is not able to form too much of a link. Okay, the gap is too much. Aap koshish karenge, maybe if you will try very hard you will be able to understand, okay, what the patient is saying is remotely connected to the previous sentence, but not so much. So making association of this is very, very tough. The third is the flight of ideas, in which there is no, actually no link with the previous thing, and the sentences are too wide apart to understand. The patient ke dimag mein baat aayi bhi kahan se, you don't know. So some of these issues, like loosening of association, derailment, flight of ideas, they point us towards the disorganized thought process in the patient's brain. Now, it is not specific that this thought process can occur in a particular disorder. Sometimes it can occur in psychosis. Sometimes it can occur in mania also. So, one last thing that I want to share before I ask Karishma to take over again is that whenever you see a certain symptom, don't be in a hurry to put the patient in the diagnostic box and check mark ki, okay, flight of ideas aa gaya, ye to DSM-5 mein likha hai ki mania mein hota hai, so I will mark mania for flight of ideas. This is not so. Flight of ideas can also occur in patients who have psychosis but have more symptoms. Okay, so don't be in a hurry to label one symptom with one diagnosis. Diagnosis will always be made with a good history and all the positive points, making your history and your diagnosis very, very strong. I hope I'm making my point clear, but interrupting Karishma in between. Karishma, I'm so sorry, I couldn't help myself. Please
okay, continue. Ma'am. Okay. So our last topic of the day is the mood in affect. So what is mood? Mood is the pervasive feeling tone which is sustained, lasts for some length of time, and the colors, the total experience of the person. An affect. Affect is the outward objective expression of the initiate cross-sectional experience of emotion at a given time. Now, what is the difference between mood and affect? I would like to explain this concept with a very beautiful example. Suppose the summers are going on, and in the summers, cloud shed and rain started. So the day when the rain started is the particular one or the 2 day, okay, that come under affect. And in the mood, which is this summer, which is still going on for the long period, pervasive feeling is the mood. Okay, see, I would like to explain it in Hindi also. Like जैसे समर चल रही है तो समर के अंदर धूप का टाइम है, उसके बीच में किसी एक आधे दिन कोई बारिश आ जाती है या बादल आ जाते हैं, तो वो जो एक आधे दिन बीच बीचाल जो बादल आना है या बारिश होना है, दैट इज इफेक्ट. बट द मोड इज विच जो समर चल रही है, गर्मियां चल रही हैं, वो मोड है बिल्कुल लाइक सेम. जैसे अगर आपके पास पेशेंट आता है, if the patient is sad, it says you that I'm sad, I'm having a sad mood from 3 to 4 months, so that cover in the mood. If the patient comes to you and say I start feeling lonely from 2-3 days, so that loneliness for the 2-3 days is to be covered under the effect. So for the today our topic is completed. Tomorrow we will continue with the thought and perception.
Okay, there were a couple of quick questions that people had asked. I'd like to answer them. Derailment is not the same as tangentiality. Tangentiality ka matlab hai, you talk about a topic. Suppose I asked about a pen and the person started saying all the things that were not related to pen, but the first answer was pen. I will be sharing a diagrammatic representation of what is derailment and what is tangentiality. When I share the resources today, I think that time it will become more clear. Derailment is when the patient starts derailing from the topic but still maintains contact with the first question at hand. Okay, some link is still there. But tangentiality is the first point of contact is the answer. Then I ask patient, what kind of pen are you using? The patient says pen and goes completely off topic and there is no link with the first topic at all. I hope that becomes clear. Quantity of speech ka examples hum log de denge. We'll give it to you. Yes, affect is overt emotion. Mood is not covert. Actually, mood is also overt only. But mood is sustained, pervasive feeling, affect tone that you keep feeling over the period of time. And that sort of affects all of the spheres of your life, including your work, your personal life, your professional life, everywhere. And hallucinations. Yes, people can have imaginative thinking, but we will be talking more about hallucinations tomorrow when we talk about phenomenology in detail. We are going to talk about the definition of hallucination, what constitutes a hallucination and what not, and how do you identify hallucination, delusion and illusion. Yes, we do have to look for neologisms and perseveration under speech examination. For people who don't know neologism and perseveration, I am going to give this to you as homework and I am going to discuss it tomorrow as well when I talk about phenomenology. What is neologism and what is perseveration? So no quick questions at this point of time. Last thing is, mood is a subjective perception. Yes, mood is more subjective. What I feel my mood is, that is a mind. That is my subjective perception. But mood can be objectively assessed also. We have a lot of tools to assess mood. For example, for depression, we have a scale called Hamilton Depression Rating Scale. For mania, we have Young Mania Rating Scale. So there are tools that will help us to objectify this subjective feeling also. Video will be sent to everybody. So I hope it is all clear. I think we are, Ishita, I know that you joined late, but we will be sending you the video, and if there is anything that's not clear, you can always get back to us. We'll like to help you. Right, so I think last few minutes are left. Anyone has any questions can start noting them down. 150, we will meet again and we will answer all of your queries. Karishma, once again, wonderful presentation, wonderful example.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you
so much.